Good morning. Throughout the ages, disciples have said, "We will follow you wherever you go." May the Lord give us the freedom to follow him in the ways of love. May the Lord give us the strength to follow him in the ways of peace. May the Lord give us the opportunity to follow him in the ways of kindness. May the Lord give us the patience to follow him in the ways of faith. May the Lord show us the joy of following God. Let us worship God on this, the Lord's Day. Welcome to worship at the Wallace Presbyterian Church. We're glad to have everyone here with us, especially those who might be visiting with us today. Please take time to sign the friendship pad and use that to greet one another in the name of Jesus Christ. Please notice the announcements in the bulletin today. Next Sunday during worship, we will celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. I hope that you can be here with us as we come to the table. Also, the church office will be closed on Thursday of this week in observance of our Independence Day. A lot of other information in the bulletin and in the calendar, and I call your attention to that. Let us worship God.
Said, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." Let us pray. Lord of heaven and earth, we long to be truly free. In this hour of worship, help us to grasp the freedom that comes from seeing you more clearly, loving you more dearly, and following you more nearly. Day by day, give us strength and courage to be your people in this time, in this place. Amen. Our first hymn is number 338.
Amen.
When we seek God's mercy, we draw close to the mystery of faith, which is love that cannot be undone by any sin that we commit. Trusting that God is grace, let us offer to God the truth of our lives as we join in a unison prayer of confession, silent prayers, and hearing the assurance of pardon. Please pray with me. God of patience, your people grow weary. We complain and question. We put you to the test. Our mouths say yes, but our deeds say no. When we wander off your path, when we fail to follow through on our good intentions, when we give our attention to trivial things, call us back to you. Empty our hearts of anger and pride. Empty our souls of greed and selfishness. Empty our minds of envy, doubt, and mistrust. As you poured out your very self through your beloved Son, pour your Spirit into our hearts today. Forgive us our wrongdoing. Reclaim us with your love. Lord, hear our prayers. Friends in Christ, our God is patient, steadfast, and understanding. Christ hears our cries of repentance. The Lord knows our hearts, inside and out. The one who created us promises to care for us, even when we turn away. Hear these words of forgiveness. Be strengthened to walk as disciples. Trust in God's mercy. Believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Let us sing God's praises for his mercy in our lives. If you go into the church kitchen, you'll see an interesting sight. Where the cabinet that used to hold all the glasses once was, is a brick wall. The cabinet fell off the wall this week, shattered all the glasses, and it's soaking wet behind there. Our church sustained a lot of damage from Hurricane Florence. We're finding more and more, just like a lot of churches up and down the eastern coast of North Carolina. Years ago, we instituted the Fifth Sunday Building Offering, and it's an opportunity to help maintain these facilities, not just to maintain the buildings, but to provide a good space for the worship of God and for the Christian nurture of his people. And that's what we take an offering today for. Thank you for your contributions. Thank you. like to invite the children to join me on the steps for the children's sermon. Thursday is the 4th of July coming up, big holiday, and people will be having fireworks and cookouts and everything, and you're going to see a lot of flags. Now, when you look at the flag, what does it make you think of? Wow, that'd be fun being at the beach all day long. Yep. You think of America, what else do you think? Anything?
Our country?
Our country, yeah.
Hmm?
The wars, yeah. A lot of people look at the. A lot of people look at the flag and they think about the. About the freedoms that we have, the freedom to do what we're doing right now, coming to worship. Nobody told us we couldn't come, and we get to worship the way we want to, or the freedom to get together and have meetings, and the freedom to say what we want, what we believe. So a lot of freedoms, and it reminds us of the wars that people fought in to protect those freedoms. So you see a lot of flags this week, and people celebrating our independence. Now, this is what you call a symbol. You ever heard that word?
Yeah.
A symbol. Not like you play in the band, but a symbol is something that stands for something else. When you look at the symbol, now that's not freedom, is it? No, but it makes you think about freedom, and that's not our country, but it makes you think about our country. I brought another symbol, and I would like to show it to you, and you tell me what it makes you think of.
The cross.
The cross.
The church.
It makes you think of the church.
Being forgiven about our sins.
Being forgiven from our sins. Who does it make you think of?
Jesus.
Makes you think of Jesus and God. That's right. So that's not Jesus, and that's not God, but it's a symbol. It reminds us, and you see crosses, a lot of crosses in here. It reminds us of how much God loves us and how God forgives us of our sins, and it reminds us of freedom. You know, the flag reminds us that we're free to do things in our country, but the cross reminds us that we're free, from sin, that we're free to be God's people, and that we're free to be followers of Jesus. So that's a very important symbol. This is too, the flag is, but the cross is a symbol that every time you see it, no matter where you are, if you see a cross, you'll know that maybe the people that live there, if you see it in a house or on a building or on somebody's chain around their neck, that you'll know that they believe in Jesus, and it'll help you think about how much God loves us, that he freed us from our sins. Let's have a prayer together. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for the freedoms we have in our country, especially the freedom to come here and worship you. And we thank you for the freedom we have in Jesus Christ, because you have freed us from our sins by sending Jesus to be our Savior. We pray in his name. Amen. Thank y'all for coming up. Krista and Grayson. Please join me in our prayer for illumination in the bulletin as we get ready to hear God's word read and proclaimed. Let us pray. Faithful God, to serve you is freedom and to know you is joy. By your Spirit, teach us the wisdom of the Scriptures that we may serve you with courage and worship you with joy through Jesus Christ, your word. Amen.
Our Old Testament lesson today comes from Exodus chapter 5. Afterward, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and said, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, let my people go so that they may celebrate a festival to me in the wilderness." But Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should heed him and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, and I will not let Israel go." Then they said, "The God of the Hebrews has revealed himself to us. Let us go a 3 days' journey into the wilderness to sacrifice to the Lord our God, or he will fall upon us with pestilence or sword." But the king of Egypt said to them, "Moses and Aaron, why are you taking the people away from their work? Get to your labors." Pharaoh continued, "Now they are more numerous than the people of the land, and yet you want them to stop working." That same day, Pharaoh commanded the taskmasters of the people, as well as their supervisors, "You shall no longer give the people straw to make bricks as before. Let them go and gather straw for themselves. But you shall require of them the same quantity of bricks as they have made previously. Do not diminish it, for they are lazy. That is why they cry, 'Let us go and offer sacrifice to our God.' Let heavier work be laid on them. Then they will labor at it and pay no attention to deceptive words." Our next hymn is number 52.
Thank you.
epistle lesson is from Paul's letter to the Christians in Galatia in the fifth chapter, the first verse, and then verses 13 to 25. I invite you to hear God's word. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh, for these are opposed to each other, to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, competing against one another, envying one another. May God bless the reading and the hearing of His word. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Elder Jason Rouse led the opening devotion at our June session meeting 12 days ago. He asked us to jot down on a piece of paper freedoms we enjoy and appreciate as a result of living in the United States. My list included the freedom to worship, the freedom of expression, the freedom of assembly, and the freedom to travel. Jason then shared thoughts about some of these very freedoms against the backdrop of a 4th of July celebration. And then he read several scriptures, including these: 2 Corinthians 3:17. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. John 8:31-32. Then Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." And Galatians 5:13, which I just read: "For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another." As we get ready to celebrate Independence Day on Thursday, let us be mindful of the freedoms we do enjoy, as Jason asked elders to think about. Also, let us think about the kind of freedom we have in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. The Supreme Court of the United States finishes its annual session and recesses for the summer in late June or early July each year, right about now. During the 2018-2019 session, court watchers and many in the public were interested in how Associate Justice Brett Kavanaugh would rule on cases after his confirmation. And now the same court watchers and members of the public and politicians will keep tabs on whether, on which justice or justices might resign or retire and who might be nominated. One of the most famous judges never to have been appointed to the U.S. Supreme Court was Judge Billings' learned hand. He was appointed by President Calvin Coolidge, and he served on the U.S. District Court for the Southern District of New York, and later he served as a judge on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit. Although he had served admirably as a judge at many different levels since 1909, Judge Hand was still relatively unknown to the general public. That changed after he made a speech in Central Park in New York City in May of 1944. Judge Hand was invited to speak at the annual I Am an American Day celebration of newly naturalized U.S. citizens. His speech was fairly short, but his words were quickly reproduced in publications such as The New Yorker, The New York Times, and Reader's Digest. His fame and his acclaim lasted until he died in 1961. Justice Hand is sometimes referred to as the 10th Justice of the Supreme Court. Although he never served on that bench, his opinions are very often cited in opinions written by the judges. In his speech in Central Park, Judge Hand asked, "What do we mean when we say that first of all we seek liberty? I often wonder whether we do not rest our hopes too much upon constitutions, upon laws, and upon courts. These are false hopes. Believe me," he said, "these are false hopes. Liberty lies in the hearts of men and women. When it dies there, no constitution, no law, no court can even do much to help it. While it lies there, it needs no constitution, no law, no court to save it. And what is this liberty which must lie in the hearts of men and women? It is not the ruthless, the unbridled will. It is not the freedom to do as one likes. That is the denial of liberty and leads straight to its overthrow. A society in which men recognize no check upon their freedom soon becomes a society where freedom is the possession of only a savage few, as we have learned in our sorrow." As he continued his speech, Judge Hand offered this explanation of liberty. "What then is the spirit of liberty? I cannot define it. I can only tell you my own faith. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which is not too sure that it is right. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which seeks to understand the mind of other men and women. The spirit of liberty is the spirit which weighs their interests alongside its own interests without bias. The spirit of liberty remembers that not even a sparrow falls to the earth unheeded. The spirit of liberty is the spirit of him who nearly 2,000 years ago taught mankind that lesson it has never learned but never quite forgotten. That there may be a kingdom where the least shall be heard and considered side by side with the greatest." As we celebrate our nation's independence on Thursday, Judge Hand's comments from 75 years ago about true liberty are certainly timely advice. Most of us are familiar with these words near the beginning of the Declaration of Independence. "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." So many times, though, those unalienable rights seem to be understood by the citizens of our nation to mean, "I can do whatever I want, and nobody can tell me any differently." That streak of American independence that we value so much can lead to self-interest at the cost of community. Freedom becomes a personal prize rather than a communal responsibility. Understanding independence to mean me first contradicts What the men who signed the Declaration of Independence on July 4th, 1776 understood true freedom to mean. In the final paragraph of our nation's founding document, Thomas Jefferson proclaimed the independence of the United Colonies, and he listed the powers of the newly free and independent states. The final sentence of the Declaration of Independence, however, interestingly enough, speaks not of independence, but of mutual dependence. And it says, "And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor." The idea that true freedom means you're free to become mutually dependent on one another is the very same idea that the Apostle Paul expresses about our freedom in Jesus Christ. In his letter to the Gentile Christians in the region of Galatia, he writes, "For freedom Christ has set you free. Stand firm. Don't become a slave and put on another yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love become slaves to one another." Some early Christians, especially the Jewish Christians in Jerusalem, accused Paul of spreading a gospel of libertinism. They were afraid that Paul's gospel could and would be heard as you're free to do anything you want as long as you have faith in Jesus Christ. In fact, it appears that some Christians, especially those in Corinth, seem to have done just that. They thought faith in Jesus Christ set them free from any and all moral constraints. Other Jewish Christian leaders in Jerusalem thought they had to balance out Paul's gospel preaching of freedom in Christ by adding strict observance to the Jewish law as requirements for the Gentiles to become believers. But Paul would have nothing to do with that teaching about the law. He didn't have a problem with God's law. After all, it was God's law. Paul did have a problem with the idea that you had to have faith plus obedience to the law in order to be saved in Jesus Christ. To live that way, Paul says, is to be subject again to a yoke of slavery. It does not mean you are free. And trying to fulfill the law by our own efforts, by our own righteous deeds, inevitably puts the spotlight on ourselves, and it leads to our self-interest and our self-righteousness. Think about the Pharisee who prayed in the temple. "I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. Thank you, God, that I'm not like other people." So it seems like there are two possibilities for living the Christian life, and they stand at opposite ends of the spectrum. One approach is do whatever you want to do, because after all, for freedom, Christ has set you free. At the other end is toe the line. Keep your nose clean, follow the rules, and somehow try to prove that you're righteous, that you're fit, that you're deserving of God's kingdom and love and mercy. But neither one of these approaches to life leaves room for faith in Jesus Christ and God's grace. Neither one of these approaches to life comes close to the idea of true freedom in Jesus Christ. In a sermon called "The Predicament of Freedom," Reverend Joanna Adams says, "To be free really means to be liberated from the prison of me, myself, and I. To be truly free is to be able to move beyond the self, and as one who is wise has put it, to move into the risk of love and to give oneself to the demand of service." She says, to be free is to be free for responsibility, not free from responsibility. And she says, "I think of how Christ Jesus, who had everything in the world going for himself, he had power, he had status, he had safety, how he chose, freely chose, to empty himself and take on the form of a servant for the sake of the world. She says, now that is freedom. On June 15th, 1215, King John of England set his seal on a document at Runnymede beside the Thames River. 4 days later, the king and the barons accepted the final version of the Magna Carta Liberatum, the Great Charter of the Liberties. The Great Charter spelled out certain rights and became a symbol of liberty and the foundation of individual freedoms. Paul's letter to the Christians in Galatia has been called the Magna Carta of the Christian life and faith. Paul's message in Galatians echoes that joyful shout, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last. But in the final analysis, the truth is we're either servants of sin or servants of Jesus Christ. Freedom in Christ for Christians does not mean standing on our own, free and independent from all restraints, free to do as we please and choose. When Paul tells us for freedom, Christ has set us free, he means free from sin, free to serve God, free to serve one another in love, free to do the right thing. The freedom of the Christian life is like coming of age as a teenager or as a young adult and finding out that the absolute freedom of being an adult is really full of responsibilities and choices and challenges. Freedom in Christ, life in the Spirit, means making choices, claiming responsibility, and ironically, limiting ourselves and our freedom in love. When Paul lists the fruit of the Spirit, he begins with love, because love is the sum and substance of what it means to be a Christian. Sometimes it's hard to know what love demands of us as Christians. We have to make hard choices. We have to make risky choices, perhaps even unpopular choices. But life in the Spirit means there is never a time when we Christians should do anything less than love God and our neighbors. There is never a time when we Christians should do anything less than to do the right thing with the complete freedom we have in Jesus Christ. That's why it can be so hard to be and live in community sometimes. Love doesn't always follow the rules that we set up and make up in life. The good news for the Christian community is that love covers a multitude of sins. In his song, Me and Bobby McGee, Kris Kristofferson wrote, freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose. Nothing don't mean nothing, hon, if it ain't free. Paul's gospel message proclaims just the opposite message. Freedom in Christ is just another word for everything to gain. In Christ, we are free from sin. We are free to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. We are free for the joy of restored relationships. We are free to be a community bound to one another in the love of Jesus Christ. And most of all, we are free to do the right thing. Let us pray. Sovereign God, ruler of our hearts, you call us to obey you, and then you give us true freedom in Jesus Christ. Give us faithfulness and courage to walk in the ways of your Son. May we use our freedom to follow in your paths and to serve your people. Amen. commend to you all the names that are listed on the prayer list in our bulletin and ask you to continue to lift up these people: Arnie Young, Andrea Castine, Joe Tillman, George Hatch, as they all continue with cancer treatments. Been asked to pray for Rita Lee, who is an employee of Michael Tichy, who is has cancer, and Michael has asked us to pray for her and for her family. Gotten a text today from Donna Pigford asking us to pray for Mitchell Carter. It's her sister-in-law's grandson, Patricia Pigford's grandson, who was in a bad wreck yesterday and is in the hospital with 4 brain bleeds and is on a vent. We've been asked to pray for Mitchell Carter. And I'd like to ask you to continue to pray for Tommy Wright, my cousin Nancy's son, diagnosed with a malignant tumor pressing on his aorta. I texted with Nancy this week. Tommy had surgery on Monday to remove a gallbladder and to put in a port line, and he's been undergoing chemotherapy treatments. He lives in Jackson, Mississippi, 37 years old. And congratulations to Katie Robinson and Matt McCordy, who were married yesterday at First Presbyterian Church in Wilmington, and it was a wonderful celebration and a happy day. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we thank you for the freedoms we enjoy to be here right now in this place, free from restraint, free from oppression, free from anyone who would say, you can't go there today to worship your God. Lord, help us not to take this for granted, because there are so many people in this world that do not have this freedom. And we pray for them wherever they are. Lord, we thank you for the freedoms we enjoy as citizens of this country. And we pray that we will use those freedoms and those blessings to work to make sure all people in this country share in those freedoms and blessings. We pray for the leaders of our country, for the leaders of our state, for the leaders of our town. They are facing very difficult decisions. And we pray for your Spirit's guidance in their hearts, for your wisdom to rule in their minds. And Lord, we pray for ourselves as a people who call ourselves united. We pray that we will work together as a community and as a nation to uphold the principles that we say we will celebrate on Thursday, especially liberty and justice for all people. We thank you for your blessings. We pray that we will be good citizens of this country. But Lord, we also know that we are citizens of your kingdom and that you have given us freedom in Jesus Christ, a freedom that comes with responsibility and with joys and blessings. And in the same spirit, we pray that we would be a community bound together in love through Jesus Christ, that we would share the good news of the gospel not only in what we say, but most especially in how we live our lives and in what we do as a church, that people will come to know the freedom in Jesus Christ, the freedom to live for you, free from sin, free to live in the Spirit. And we thank you for the great cost of that freedom in the death of Jesus Christ for our sake, and we rejoice in your great power of resurrection that has raised him from the dead and gives us the new life we have in Christ. Lord, we bring the concerns of our hearts. We bring joys, we bring sorrows, we bring burdens, and we do so because we hear our Lord's invitation: come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Lord, search our hearts and find there the cares and worries that we carry today, and we lift them up to you. Lord, with fervent prayers, we continue to pray for Arnie and for Andrea, for Joe, for George, for all others in our church and in our community and our families who are undergoing treatments for illnesses and diseases. We pray for strength of body and for courage and for comfort. Lord, we pray for Rita and for her family. We pray for Michael as her employer and boss. We pray for her comfort and for her strength and for her family. Lord, we pray for Mitchell Carter and for his family. Lord, surround this young man with your healing touch and with your love. We pray for his family as they wait. Lord, we lift him up to you. Lord, I pray for Tommy, for Nancy and Tom and their whole family. Pray for him as he undergoes these treatments. Ask you to bless him as they go to the doctors and go through more surgeries. Lord, we pray for his recovery. And Lord, we thank you for the joy that Katie and Matt have found in one another and for their marriage. Ask you to bless them in their life to come as husband and wife. Thank you for the celebration yesterday, and ask you to keep them safe in the days and years to come. Lord, we thank you for Jesus Christ. We pray that we will be his faithful disciples. And we ask all these things in his name as we pray together his prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us present our tithes and offerings as a part of our worship. Thank you. us pray. Holy God, you call us by name and invite us into the life of faithfulness and obedience. As we offer our gifts this morning, may we bring not only our wealth, but our whole lives, ready to listen and to follow where you would send us for the sake of your kingdom and Christ coming again. Amen. Let us affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our final hymn is number 354. Natalie and I had a really great visit with my mom in Cumming, Georgia this week, and I told her, a lot of people said to tell her hello, and she said to tell all of you hello, and she said, that's really kind of my church. She said, they're so wonderful to me, I still hear from people, so she really appreciates that, and so do I. So hello from my mom. Now go out with these words. May we live a life centered in God, free in Christ to do the right thing, a life that bears rich fruit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, tolerance, self-control, all the good things that come from following the Spirit. For living this way will bring much praise and glory to our God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Amen.